need to get some pens. Well, I gotta have some pens and I can't find them. Oh, here's some. Hey, Sheldon, what are you doing down here? Trying to get taught? Or get caught? I had some boxes of these, and I don't know what happened to them. Had some boxes of pens. Can't find them.
Right here, Jim. They're right here.
Huh?
They're right there.
Over here?
Yeah.
Oh. They're on the wrong end. Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
All right, so 20 seconds.
Phil, the fix-it man.
All right, 10 seconds. Five seconds. Four.
Oh, wait a minute. Let me get my, I got to get my sword here. I don't have my sword out. And I, well, I probably could preach without it, but I'd rather have it. All right. Okay. All right. All right. It's Wednesday night, and we're talking about my favorite subject, and it goes in every direction. That's the word predestination. Predestinate has to do with everything that's going on in the world, everything in the Bible. I've got a T-shirt that says, predestination is the only way to heaven. And it is. Well, I thought belief was the only way to heaven. Well, it is. I thought repentance was the only way to heaven. Well, it is. What do you mean? They're all the same thing. The whole point about predestination, God has to pick us out and cause us to live right, because living right is the only way to heaven. I can stick that in everywhere. The whole purpose of predestination, God says, my people are going to go through the narrow way, and that's the only way to heaven too. Narrow way. And the believe is the only way to heaven. I got a T-shirt on the front. It says, predestination, the only way to heaven. On the back, it says, believe, the only way to heaven. And then you've got all of these other words. Repent is the only way to heaven. Repent. And you can name everything, but accept Christ won't get you there. That's not the only way to heaven. All these mean the same thing. Predestinate. Predestination is the only way to heaven. The reason being, the Bible says There is none good. No, not one. There's none that understandeth. Not one. There is none that seeketh after God. If nobody seeks God, and if every man at his best state, the best thing you can be, best state is the word tamim, T-A-M-I-Y-M in the Hebrew, and it means upright, the most upright a thing a man can do or be is altogether vanity. Vanity won't get you into heaven. Vanity is the word hebel, H-E-B-E-L, and it means worthless. All men are worthless. The only thing that's good in a man is the new birth, and you can't bring yourself to that. Therefore, God has to birth you by His will. New birth is the only way to heaven. Born again is the only way to heaven. New birth, but all of these are the same. Faith is the only way to heaven, but faith is merely the noun form of believe. This is the word pistuo. This is the word pistis. P-I-S-T-E-U-O. And faith is P-I-S-T-I-S. The only way you can get to heaven by faith is that is a gift of God. God has to put faith in you since there's nothing good in you and nobody seeks God. Well, the new birth is by God's will, not by your will, God's will. So that would be the only way to heaven. And the new birth would have to do with death to self, which is faith. And the way there is the narrow way, the thalibo way, T-H-L-I-B-O. Way, and when you are made alive in Christ by the will of God, quickened, made alive is the only way to heaven. Quickened, make alive. Zumpoio is the word, make alive. That's the only way you can get into heaven by being Z-O-O-P-O-I-E-O. I think that's the same thing as the new birth, isn't it? To quicken and make alive from the dead. And repent means to be turned, because you can't turn yourself when there's none good. To be turned and think differently. And when you're turned and you think differently, metanoia is the word, M-E-T-A-N-O-I-A. When you're turned and you think differently, God has to arrange your thinking, because He says, your thoughts are not my thoughts, over there in Isaiah, the 55th chapter. Isaiah 55, you can't think like I think. I have to birth you, and I have to cause you to repent and be turned around and go a completely different direction than where you were going. And that is the narrow way. The narrow way, thalibo, comes from the word tribulation. And Paul said that's the only way to heaven. We must through much tribulation enter the kingdom of God. So it doesn't matter. All the Bible is all like one word, and we're just trying to say it. Now, all of these, in any other way you can come up into heaven, they're all exactly related to each other. And predestination is about the pathway there. Narrow is the pathway there, pathway to heaven. Well, if that's the way there, it has to come by new birth, being quickened by God. He quickens who He wills. And then He puts us on a journey of righteousness. And when He puts us, He's got a wrestling match going on in this body. We've got the inner man, which is Christ, and the outer man, which is self. And it's a battle all the way to righteousness and learning to rest in the things of God. When you rest, I heard people for years say, well, you've got to rest in the things of Christ. What is resting in the things of Christ? It's resting in everything in the world. He works all things after the counsel of His own will. People say, well, that means good things. That means all things. I can't understand sometimes things that are happening in my life, and I'm sure you got things that you can't understand, but it is the will of God. when someone's family member dies here, I say, well, you know that's the will of God, don't you? They'll say, yes, I know that. This is the thing about predestination. When you begin to realize, and that's not going to happen overnight. It's not going to happen today or tomorrow. It's going to be a long process of happenings and understanding. When you start to realize that everything that's going on in life is the will of God to conform us to His likeness. That's what predestination is about. The people, the whoms He did foreknow. God doesn't love everybody. He only loves His wife, the church, and gave Himself for her. And everybody's not in the church. We're called out of this world to live godly the same way that they were called out of Egypt. They were called out of Egypt to go to the promised land, and the promised land was called God's rest, according to Hebrews the third and the fourth chapter. And the rest, the Bible says, Israel would enter into God's rest. The word is katapausis. Katapausis means to settle down. It comes from kata and pause. It means to pause down or stop or rest down. And God says there was a people over there in that came out of Egypt with the rest of the children of Israel. And when they came out, they were disobedient to God. They didn't believe God. They didn't believe all the miracles that He performed. And yet He did. When they came out of Egypt here, came out of Egypt and had to go through that wilderness, the Bible compares the wilderness that they had to go through, and that's this tongue right here, right there, Red Sea. There's a Red Sea, comes up in both sides of that tongue of land. And when they came down here, everything that went on with them for 40 years in the wilderness is compared to our lives as believers. And God kept saying there was a group of believers all along the way, and God would kill 280 here and kill 1,000 or 14,000 here and kill more over here and kill some over here. And He said, they could not enter into My rest, speaking of Israel at that time or Canaan, they couldn't enter into My rest because of their unbelief, and they had to die. And I said this last week, and I've been saying it. What has to die is the outer man, and God's got to take us. The inner man is going to be alive and require that the outer man or the unbelieving man die. And that's what it takes in our lives. The only thing unbelief equals no Sabbath. And when we say believe, we're not talking about, do you believe in Jesus as your Savior? We're not talking about that. We're talking about everything that's going on. And it takes a lot of years, just like it did Israel, to learn to believe and get rid of their unbelief. I've talked to several people lately, particularly a young man down in Atlanta today. And his father was listening to us for years. His name is Rodrigo Bonifante. And Rodrigo had told me years ago, he said, I was diagnosed years ago with bipolar. And he said, I was diagnosed as manic depressive. And he said, I understand that you said years ago you don't believe in that. I don't believe in that. You don't find that in the Bible. The only place you find it, in a sense, is the fellow supposedly that had the demon there in Luke 8. In the Bible, when you look at the words, I went online and I pulled out some of these things on manic depression and bipolar and schizophrenia. I'm going to give you a personal testimony and tell you what I believe this is. There's people in the world that are weaker than others. They have a weaker disposition. And a lot of their weaker disposition has to do with their environmental upbringing. A real aggressive parent, very abusive parent, or environmental situation that they didn't know how to come out of, and they were very gentle, very quiet, very reposed in the world, and they didn't know how to get along with the world, and somebody's bullying them and pushes them into a corner. I was pushed in that corner by a very bullying father. I used to tell him, "We were terrified of you when we were growing up." I only told him that after I got in my 30s, because I could talk up to him by then. And he just screamed at me at the top of his lungs and said, "That makes me so mad when y'all tell me that you are scared to death of me." And I said, "You got it right there." It was funny the way he said it. But he terrified me. When he drove into the driveway, I would just tremble. "Oh, God, he's here. Oh, God." And I was scared to death of him. He would tell me that I was clumsy, that I didn't have good sense. And I was the only one that grew up to read and educate myself. My older brother, my younger brother, my sister didn't. I was considered later on, I guess, in a sense, the brain in the family, because they never studied or read anything. And I went through so many things. I thought I couldn't get a decent job. I got out of school. My father had helped me get some job driving an old, they had a bunch of neighborhood laundries and things like that, and I'd work that kind of a job. I think, I'm never going to be able to do a good job at doing anything. I thought there was something wrong with me. And all it was my father had just browbeat me. I could never have imagined that I would stand in a pulpit. At 20 years old, I couldn't have even thought that I would stand and teach out of the Greek text and give you parts of speech of the Greek, or that I would be a whiz of a salesman in my 40s. I could never have even seen that. It was because of all that abuse. Even my sister said, my father would look at you and you were the little skinny kid in the middle that didn't matter, and that he would just pay no attention to you. He'd scream at us, all of us. I mean, top of his lungs, just ringing the roof, just because something didn't happen his way. Be careful how you treat people that are really backward, because I was very backward. You wouldn't have believed that. I could not. My sister would tell me, "Jimmy, speak up. Nobody can understand you. You're always mumbling." That went on my whole life till I got up, got out on the road, and I had to learn how to get out of that. And I believe that is where so-called manic depression, I was told by a doctor at Vanderbilt when I was about 26, "You're going to be a schizophrenic the rest of your life, and you will cry the rest of your life, and you have to be on medication the rest of your life." Do I look like that? That guy got it wrong, bad wrong. I don't believe in manic depression. I don't believe in schizophrenia. And when you read these things on it, it sounds like what I'm preaching. That man in Luke 8, the Bible says that he was possessed with demons. Possessed with demons, D-A-I-M-O-N-I-Z-O-M-A-I. If you have a McClintic and Strong, look up the word possessed. And it'll say with, in little bitty words, demons. And then it will say down in the copy that it means to be insane. Insane, when you look up the word insane, it tells you more or less the same thing that you get out of these papers off the internet about paranoia. It says the basic same things, brain behavior, that it's unsound thinking. You know what I believe? I don't believe the doctors know what they're talking about when they're talking about. I'm going to tell you what I believe it is. I have examined my life and watched my life, and I had good sense, and I didn't know I did, and I didn't know I was evaluating all the time, but I was. I was even evaluating as a kid. And I can read this and tell you these things happen in my life. Schizophrenia is a severe, chronic, and generally disabling brain and behavior disorder. But you know what I believe? I believe if they diagnosed everybody in the world, about 95% would be diagnosed schizophrenia. I don't believe that. The man was said he was possessed with devils, means to be insane. It means unable to think soundly. To think soundly, and that was my problem. I couldn't think sound because my thinking had been beaten into submission. And then when he came to his right mind, sophroneo mind, and you find the word sober, it's usually this word, being sober in the Bible, it's this word sophroneo. And sophroneo means sane mind. This is the only place you can find in the Bible. Men are out of their minds because they're geared that way, and whenever you go after people who don't seem to be able to have it together, it says they're deluded, thought disorders, and hallucinations. Hallucinations is imagining. There's people that imagine somebody. They imagine things about people that's not going on. It's not true. Well, what is it, Jim? I want to tell you there's been a switch in thinking in America. America's thinking is perverted. We've been talking about that on Sunday morning, how their minds are turned around. You can't give them a definition or anything. I believe in America that the rich and the wealthy oppress the poor. The poor, the brokenhearted. The Bible says you have to be brokenhearted. The bruised, the crushed. This is who the world goes after, and they crush them because they're rich, they're powerful, they've learned to play a mind game with the world. They've learned to play politically with the world, and I believe that what they're doing is they oppress the downtrodden, and it takes a long time for these downtrodden people to come out of what they're in, especially when they're out there battling with the world. But here's the whole thing that we're talking about. God is raising up the rich to a... The Bible says the rich oppress the poor, doesn't it? That's... Look at a couple of verses here. Look over here. In James, let me tell you something about the rich. I've worked in real estate. I was really good at it, but I had to sell the working class because I didn't fit into the country club class. I just didn't fit in with them. And I found out that if you work hard, you get something done. That's really all it takes. Use good common sense, work hard, and you go somewhere and do something with your life. Look here in James, the first chapter. James, the second chapter, excuse me. James, the second chapter. And this is what happens in life. James, I'll get it right in a minute. All right. James 2. And when you've got a weak person with a mind that's on the really... It's on the side of being just being able to be led around, and you should never do that just because you can lead somebody around. You shouldn't look down on them because they appear to be less than you. Some of them, it has to do with their upbringing, with the oppression they've gone through. Then you go over here to James, the second chapter. Hearken, my beloved brethren, in verse 5, hath not God chosen the poor of this world that are rich in faith and heirs of the kingdom, which he hath promised to them that love him? But you have despised the poor. Did not rich men oppress you and draw you before judgment seats? Do not they, the rich, blaspheme that worthy name by which ye are called? And let's go over here to go back to Psalms 62. All right. Look at verse 9. I've given this so many times, it's really getting a stronger meaning to me now. Surely men of low degree are vanity. God sent me putting all of us in the same basket. men of low degree are vanity. Now, men of low degree would be people that work as clerks in the grocery store, people that are truck drivers, people that work in a not educated environment. You don't have to have a lot of education. That's not to say that they're not as smart as the rest. They didn't have the opportunities as the rest had. And then he goes on to say vanity, men of low degree, hebo, worthless. He's saying outside of Christ, you're worthless. Worthless. And men of high degree are a lie. I keep telling everybody this. And it's real hard for people here at Grace and Truth to get a hold of it. All of the world, everybody in the world is not good. Your banker does not understand truth. He may go to some church, he calls it a church, and I'm not saying every one of them, but the majority of the world are these men of high degree. That's the majority of the Bible says. Many are going into the broadway that leads to destruction. Many there be that go in thereat, and only a few love God, and they're always these that are poor in spirit. Jesus said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Lord has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor, the emptied out, to the brokenhearted and the bruised. That's who God came to call. You have to be emptied out of self. Along the way somewhere, it may have been when you were young, you may have a good job now, but you may have gone through so much oppression that you didn't realize that was for your good, and we know that all these things work together for good to them that love God. He said, men of low degree are a lie. That means, when I say this to you, when you walk out the door, think of these verses. Every man at his best state is altogether vanity. That means the most respectable people you run into in life, whether it's your boss, a company owner, it's some wealthy guy that gets on TV and looks like he's a nice guy, the Bible says he's not. And that includes Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump and Bill Gates and Warren Buffett, and name off all of these rich people in the world and all the local rich guys, none of them are good, but they put on this front like they are. If you didn't think you had to live up to their standard, you wouldn't think they were so hot. I keep saying this, and I don't know if anybody gets a hold of it. Since all this is true, and there's none good, and nobody will birth himself into the kingdom, if anybody's going to heaven, they'll have to get in by God, because all of them are worthless. If you come to the place where you realize that, when you go out in public, you won't feel like you have to defend yourself when somebody does you wrong, because they're that way. God made them that way. He fixed their minds so they'll hurt people. People are not out to get you. They're out to advance themselves. They're greedy. They're full of desire for money, and the love of money is the root of all evil. Therefore, this is not a personal thing with you. This is a personal thing with themselves, that they want to get ahead no matter who they have to step on or walk over. What we have to come to is learn that if all these people are this way, you still got a little bit of that in you. And God's having to work that out of all of us, all of that none righteous, not one, none understands, none seeks after God, not a just man upon the earth that doeth good and sins not, and all drink iniquity like water. That's every person, and the only part of us that doesn't drink iniquity like water is that inner man, and he's working on us, and he's putting us through trial and fire and persecution. And what that does to a weak believer makes them paranoid. If they go to the doctor after so much persecution by the world, you have to learn to understand that's the will of God in your life. And you know the only thing I got to thinking today, the only thing that will get you through that, and the only thing that got me through this that I had when I was young, I had to go through phases. I got real angry at the world because I didn't know what to do with the world. I thought everybody was oppressing me, so I'd get mad at them, scream at them, yell at them, cuss at them. And I found out years later when I went through all these passages in my life. There's a book called Passages from Years Ago. And it talks about all the different steps we have to go through. And those of us that go through it, we wake up when we get older and we say, that's what's supposed to be. That's the way it's supposed to be. When we come to the realization that God's planned everything in our life, particularly the evil, what He's going to do is send evil men our way. This is not personal to you. God puts evil men, crisscrosses them, even takes our old man personalities and causes them to clash in church with others until all of us learn that that's not the way to live. The most peaceful life I've had is the last 10 years because I've learned to just accept things the way they are. That's what God is saying we have to do. It doesn't matter who did you wrong or who you think did you wrong. When you look at these papers on that I've got up here, and it's talking about delusions, bipolar, people being irritated and confused and angry, we're never to be that way. But you won't get over that until you go through enough trials that makes you wake up one day and say, everything I ever did, I've done this whole thing wrong my whole life. I've got to change. I got to think different. I need to really learn to repent every day. That's what repent means. To pull away from your old self. Getting angry, when I used to get angry all the time, made me sick. Does it do that to anybody? Makes me literally physically ill. I'd get just sick of myself. And what I'm wanting to help you to see, all of the negative things in your life, God has brought it about for your good. And you say, well, don't feel good to me. I don't like that. Well, you haven't learned with that kind of an attitude. If it's the will of God, what are we going to argue with Him? There's a verse over here in, he goes on to say, if they're laid in the balance, both men of high degree and low degree, if you put, here's a balance, and here's vanity down here, and here's men of high degree and men of low degree, and they're all together, everything that they are, and this includes you, includes me, we're all together lighter than nothing. Now, if you get to realizing how small you are in the scheme of things, everybody here needs to get that DVD documentary. We need to get everybody a copy of it. It's called Edge of the Universe. When you watch that and you think you're important, it makes you look smaller than a grain of sand. It's a magnificent documentary. But look over here, and I started to go somewhere and I forgot where I was going. I looked up paranoia here. Paranoia just means, they say, a mental disorder. The only thing that causes disorder in the world are men's minds. If you come to a place, it's kind of like going to an entertainment park, like one of these entertaining places, going there on a ride into a ghost house, and you got all these scary things, and somebody's in there throwing knives at you and doing all this. Well, this is your life that God is the one that planned it, and He's going to take you all the way through it. It's like a program, and you can't get angry at people that do things. It's an imagination to think they're just out to get you. Those people are out to get everybody that gets in their way of what they want. Well, the Bible is teaching us you don't have any right to get angry at that because I'm the one that planned it. If God's plan to put men together or women together and you can't get along with them, you can. I used to think I couldn't get along with them. I get along with people by letting them be who they are. Everybody has got a disposition and a personality. And some of them were made to clash. Yours was made to clash with somebody. God made those people, put them in your life the way He wanted them, so you'll clash and clash and clash until one day you'll get heart problems, and you'll get ulcers, and you'll get this, or you get asthma and bronchitis, or every time you get sick, one of these things will break out on you. And God says, I'm going to keep doing this to you till you learn that I'm doing this, and those people that you don't get along with are not doing it. It's me. He said, in everything give thanks. This is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. I don't care what it is. I really honestly believe this, that if a person will come to that realization of resting in the fact that God is doing everything in their life, especially all the negative, your health will get better. You won't get over dying, because you're going to die. Your gray hair is still there. Your wrinkles are there. But I really believe that if we can rest in the Lord, that if we can come to this place of trust in the Lord with all thine heart, lean not unto thine own understanding. Well, I understand that I don't like that, and I don't like the way they did me. Well, that's your understanding. God says, my understanding is what I'm doing, and there's nothing going on in anybody's life that I'm not ordering it. Adolf Hitler killed 6 million Jews because God ordered it. And the Jews have been killed over 2,600 years because God ordered it all. Well, it seems unfair to me. That's because you want fair. God says, I'm not fair. I do the things I want to do. I've declared the end from the beginning and from ancient times, everything that's not yet done. Look at Psalms 135. Psalms. We need to get in our heads. If we can get a hold of our mind and our thinking, but we can't, but God can. We've got to get it out of our mind. Well, they're trying to destroy me. He's trying to destroy me. She's trying to destroy me. No. If they're acting wrong, all they've got is an outer man, and if they're an unbeliever, they're supposed to do you as bad as they can because you've got a situation where they can make money out of it, and they're supposed to cheat and lie and steal. And God says, I've got you in it until I am going to bring you out of it, and I'm going to make you, I'll beat you and beat you and beat you and beat you with a scourge over and over and over and over till you learn. He scourges every son he receives. Well, it don't appear like I'm learning. Well, you better give up. You better stick your hands in there and say, I surrender to God. You don't tell your enemies you surrender. You surrender to God, but you quit fighting them. Does anybody have any enemies? Has anybody ever had any? Boy, I had to get over mine. They ate me alive inside of me. I'll tell you what, the best way to live is to stop living that way. And I began to realize, and I've started this afternoon, I went and made me copies of knowledge, knowing, instruction, wisdom. I'm going to read all this I can out of the Bible because I believe the more you know, the more you learn. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom instruction. You don't fear God if you're allowing people to come in your life and put you in a turmoil. You don't have any fear at all because you don't really believe that's God. You think that's your enemy, and it's not. It's God. God's going to cross our path with evil men to straighten us out. And He'll keep doing it until we learn to behave ourselves. We have to behave to Him, not to the world. Something has happened in my life I cannot express. When I quit fighting people about 12, 14 years ago, I don't have the hard time I used to have with the people I used to have it with, because I used to pick everything apart that they would do, and I didn't like what they were doing. But God put them there until I said, I surrender. God, I'm not going to fight no more. I've had people fight me here, and I won't fight them back. Try that. See if that'll work. Live like Christ. We're predestined to conform to His likeness, aren't we? But we want to, I'll be like Christ, but this guy got to take care of him first. That's a really way to do it, isn't it? I'm sorry, but that ain't like Jesus at all. You have to stop right here, right now, and start conforming. But I know this is everybody here, isn't it? Huh? Has everybody had, I know some of you and who your enemies are. And I'm sure there's no temptation taken to you, but such as is common to me. That's the major problem that's going on in our head, and we wrestle with it all the time. Where did I say we were going? Psalms 135. I believe it's 135. I like this. I like Psalms 135. All right. Now, praise ye the Lord, praise ye the name of the Lord. The reason he said praise the Lord, he's going to say, I want you to learn to give God credit for what he's doing. Praise is giving God credit. You can't praise the Lord as long as you have any praise in your heart for yourself. Isaiah the 42nd chapter says, my praise will I not give to another. I'm not going to share my praise with you as long as you're taking glory in your life and what you're doing. I'm not in that. God says, I ain't going to put up with it. The reason men fight, and the reason they become paranoid, is because they feel like they don't deserve what they're getting. I don't deserve this. Well, yes, we do. God has punished us less than our iniquities deserve. And he's going to raise up evil men to cut us down. They're called swords of the Lord. Deliver even me from the wicked, which is thy sword in thy hand. Yeah, well, I'll act right as long as he acts right. Well, then you ain't acting right. The Pharisees never did act right. When they took Jesus to kill him, were they acting right? They murdered him. And what did Jesus do? He submitted to it. Life gets easier when you start submitting to your enemies. And don't always think things about them that you don't know. And don't even think it anyway, because if you did know it, all it'll do is make it more angry. Now he says here in Psalms, praise ye the Lord, praise the Lord, the name of the Lord. Praise him, O you servants of the Lord. Ye that stand in the house of the Lord, in the courts of the house of our God, praise the Lord, for the Lord is good to his people. Who is this book written to? Psalms. It's written to God's people. It's not written to the devil's people. For the Lord hath chosen Jacob, which is Israel, unto himself, and Israel for his peculiar treasure, and that's us. For I know that the Lord is great, and that our Lord is above all gods. Whatsoever the Lord pleased, that did he in the heavens, and in the earth, and in the seas, and all the deep places. Every place you can look, what's going on in your mind, in your life, is of God. He causeth the vapors to ascend from the ends of the earth. He maketh lightnings for the rain. He makes the lightning. He said in Job 37 and 38, he said, the thunders roll. They're my thunders. They're my lightnings. I command the lightnings to strike here, and they answer me. And we're going to talk back to him. Who hath known the mind of the Lord that he may instruct him? Who has been his counselor? You're going to counsel God and say, I don't like this in my life. The sooner we come to a place of resting in the things of God, the sooner your life gets easier. Well, Jim, you can say that because, well, you're right. I can say it because God's about beat me half to death. That's the only reason. He smote the firstborn of Egypt, and some of those women said, what are you killing my kids for? We ain't done nothing to you. We're just a little Egyptian woman. God says, I kill who I want to. I'll kill your babies. Both of man and beast. Well, you killing my cattle out there. Jehovah God, I don't have anything to do with you. Have you ever stopped to think that God was killing all the firstborn of the Egyptians, some little lady out there, and she hadn't done anything, and she didn't even know what was going on with between Moses and Pharaoh. And God's killing them. When you know that God is doing this, don't sit and fight with God. God sent tokens and wonders in the midst of thee, O Egypt, upon Pharaoh and upon all his servants. And the servants didn't know that they needed blood of a lamb outside their on their doorposts, and God killed them. Who smote great nations and slew mighty kings, Sihon, king of the Amorites, and Og, king of Bashan, and all the kingdoms of Canaan, and gave their land for inheritance and inheritance unto Israel, his people. Thy name, O Lord, endureth forever. Your Shem, your authority. This is God's authority that men are talking against. Christians that can't settle in and begin to rest in God. You say, Jim, I can't do that all of a sudden. I know you can't. But at least say to yourself, this is the will of God, and it's not the will of that person that's doing this to me. Oh, that it may be in there. It's what their will is, it's in the sovereign will of God what they're doing. Everything that you've gone through, all the sadness you've gone through, was supposed to be there. O Lord, endureth forever, and thy memorial, O Lord, throughout all generations. For the Lord will judge his people, and he will repent himself concerning his servants. Repent means to turn. The idols of the heathen are silver and gold, the work of the men's hands. They have mouths, but they speak not. Eyes have they, but they see not. They have ears, but they hear not. The hearing ear and the seeing eye of the Lord have made even both of them. Your enemies, God made them your enemies. He gave them a bad attitude, or he gave you a bad attitude, or he gave you both clashing attitudes. Neither is there any breath in their mouths. When he says that, he's talking about their dead gods, that they make them are like unto them. Those that make these gods are just like them, they're dead. So is every one that trusteth in them. Bless the Lord, O house of Israel. Bless the Lord, O house of Aaron. Bless the Lord, O house of Levi. Ye that fear the Lord, bless the Lord. But you're not fearing God if you're talking back to his actions. We talk back to the actions of God when we fight our enemies. Fighting my enemies has been one of my worst problems in my lifetime. It just about killed me. Blessed be the Lord out of Zion, which dwelleth at Jerusalem. Praise ye the Lord. Notice how many times he said bless and praise. Bless him that does what he wants to do. Go back to Jude now. Go back to Jude. If we can learn this, anytime we are fighting the status quo, if we're fighting what's going on, what God is doing with all this negativity in our lives is causing us to bow to his resting. To stop fighting the world. We can't do that. We have no business. This is something I never heard preachers preach when I was young, and it's come to me through the fact that he's caused me to do this. God has caused me to rest. I don't really have the problems I used to have with my health or anything else. And you can't get there when you're young. But be praying, Lord, help me to see these things. Now, go back here to Jude. I really like this verse, as much as any verse that I've ever seen about us fighting against the will of God. I don't care what it is in your life. It is the will of God. What God is saying, accept this because I insist. And it might take him 40 years to get our attention. It took him a long time to get mine. Had a lot of rebellion in me. I was never unfair with people. The reason I would scream and get mad, I'd scream and get mad over being right. I was right. I knew I was right. And a lot of the causes I was right in, but my response was wrong. It was just as wrong as the person that was making the accusation. And I've learned not to do that. The scripture says, judgment is mine, there in Romans 12, I will repay, thus saith the Lord. If anybody gets paid back, I'll do it. You step back and walk away. But you got to learn. You have to come to the realization in your mind that this is God. And when you do, you'll bypass your enemy and go straight to God and say, this is you, isn't it, God? He says, yes. Now, that's what the Bible tells us. If he works all things, if known unto God are all his works from the beginning, what does he know? He knows everything. Everything he's ordained. I actually believe there are car wrecks out there right now happening in the world. There's a lightning striking something that's going to burn a building down. And all of this has been planned by God before the foundation of the world. And I believe that there's a car sliding on some gravel somewhere right now, somewhere out there across the country, and the gravel is flying in the exact trajectory that God has ordained for it to fly in eternity past. And it's bending the bumpers exactly to the degree he wants them to bend, and people are dying the way he wants them to die. I don't believe there's anything out of the control of the living God. That's something that most of the Calvinists or the predestinationists won't agree with me on. They say, well, we have free will to do what we want. Well, you get 150 miles and 10 years down the road and the things that are happening, you say, this is the will of God, and one of your friends gets killed and a train hits somebody at some crossing. You say, this is the will of God, not without everything going on that went on to get them at that point. And if something happens in your life, it's the will of God. Even your unwillingness to repent right now is the will of God. Even your unwillingness to get on that straight and narrow and live in that narrow way, that's also the will of God. Boy, when we really come to believing predestination is what it is, it'll scare you. It has actually frightened me. Has anybody ever just been driving along or sitting at home somewhere and all of a sudden it hit you that everything is of God? And it's actually scared me. I'm going, whoa, wow, whoa. Next time you're praying over your food, stop and think who you are talking to. It'll stop you in your tracks sometime. You'll go, oh, Lord, you know, I don't know. I've actually started stuttering to that point when I think about who I'm talking to. Now, look here in Jude. God is talking about evil men. Don't know quite where to start. He's talking about, this is a sister chapter to 2 Peter. It reads just nearly like 2 Peter, the second chapter. He's talking about these brute beasts, same thing, he calls them the same thing in 2 Peter, the second chapter. Let me read verse 10. These speak evil of those things which they know not. And that's what people do when they are paranoid, when some doctor tells you you've got bipolar or something like that. I believe what really makes people feel that way are the people on top oppressing the people on the bottom and saying, I am the one who's in authority and I know more. No, you're a sinner like me. But what they know naturally as brute beast, brute alogos, A-L-O-G-O-S, means no word. A-L-O-G-O-S. It's the word ba'ar in the Old Testament. It's that word alogos in 2 Peter, the second chapter. It means no word of God. They don't have any word of God written in their hearts. They're not believers. In those things, they corrupt themselves. Phthiro, P-H-T-H-E-R-O. Their thinking is rotten. Your thinking has to change. It has to change and come to a rest down in your life. Woe to them, for they have gone in the way of Cain, had the works of their hands, and ran greedily after the heir of Balaam for reward, and perished in gainsaying of Korah. Korah was there in that 16th chapter of Numbers when he was arguing with God. He was saying, I think I should be able to. Remember we've been talking about the book of Numbers and how that all these people arguing with God is a picture of the outer man and they have to die. Well, Korah had to die. He said, I think I should be able to offer incense. Who does Moses and Aaron think they are leading Israel? What about me? I'm important. And Moses tells Korah, you get your people and come out here tomorrow and meet me here with your incense. And he came out, and Moses looked at Korah and his... They were fighting the will of God. You can't, just because you are a Levite, don't mean you can be offering offering incense. You had to be in the high priest's family. And Moses says, now, Korah, all your men here, 200 what, 250 of them? If I'm not the messenger of God, this ground is not going to open up just here in a moment and swallow you. And it did. God says, back to work. They were fighting the will of God. Then he goes on to say, these are spots in your feast of charity. They are antilogia, A-N-T-I-L-O-G-I-A. That's not even hard to understand. Anti-logos. They're against the word of God as they come and feast with you here and sit with you at Grace and Truth. These are spots in your feast of charity when they feast with you, feeding themselves without any fear of God. Clouds they are, without water. They don't have any Holy Spirit in them. Carried away about of winds, trees whose fruit withereth, without fruit, twice dead. Well, they're dead spiritually, and they're going to die in hell forever. Death means separation. Plucked up by the roots, raging waves of the sea, that's the same thing in 2 Peter, the second chapter says, foaming out their own shame, wandering stars. Planetes is one of the words deceive. Comes from the word planos, which is one of the words deceive. And we get the word planet from planetes. It means a wandering star. It's not a star. A planet is not a star. A planet has no light. Our moon is a planet. It is not a sun. A sun is a star in our words. So what it is saying here, these people have no light, no truth. They're like a planet wandering in space. A star, all stars are suns. They're big masses of gas burning. And our star is a sun. They said it'll last another 5 billion years. Now, and then it'll burn out. These are the spots of your feast of charity when they feast with you, feeding themselves without fear. Clouds they are without water, carried about of winds. They have no stability in them. Trees whose fruit withereth, without fruit, twice dead, plucked up by the roots, raging waves of the sea, foaming out in their own shame, wandering stars to whom is reserved the blackness of darkness forever. These are vessels of wrath fitted for destruction. And Enoch also, the seventh from Adam, prophesied of these, saying, behold, the Lord cometh with 10,000s of his saints to execute judgment upon all and to convince or to persuade all that are ungodly among them of all their ungodly deeds which they have ungodly committed, and all their hard speeches which ungodly sinners have spoken against them. These are murmurers. What you're doing is putting yourself in a class with complainers. They're murmurers, complainers, more like that. Mempsi moros, M-E-M-P-S-I. M-E-M-P-S-I. Let me get the spelling on this. It's a long word. Mempsi, M-O-I-R-O-S. It means to blame the fates. When you look at fate, it's what will happen, it's what is happening, what has happened, and what will happen. And who is it declared all of that? You're blaming all the works of God when you fight this great orderly arrangement. You're fighting what God has ordained to be. But you know who that is it's fighting? It's that outer man. And he stands alive and well in a lot of believers until enough fire and trials come to your life and you surrender and say, Lord, I give up. I'm not going to fight these people no more in the world. That's what Israel was doing over here in the Old Testament. When they come out of Egypt, they had a lot of unbelievers out there. And I'm going to get back into some of these unbelievers. The unbelievers and the believers that came out of Egypt, it's as though they were one person, but the unbelieving part, God's got to kill it. That's just like you and I. When we're fighting the world, we're arguing with God. The inner man is Christ in you, and the outer man is self, and that's the demon in you. And the outer man, when it's fighting the inner man, and you're in a war that you're going to lose. You ain't going to win that. I'm here as a personal testimony to tell you, you can't win that battle. God will bury you, or you'll think you're being buried if you belong to Him. David was as strong a man as there was. God put this woman on this housetop next to the palace so he could see her. And she was sunning herself in the sun, and he said, I want her. And he even knew her, because that was Ahithophel's granddaughter, and Ahithophel was David's chief counselor, a man that David trusted. David got involved in things, and he ended up murdering her husband. And he's a writer of the Psalms. I've had people come here and say, well, I can't come to your church. I've got too many bad things in my past. Have you ever murdered one of your best friends, one of the most faithful friends, and then stole his wife and got her pregnant? You ever done anything like that? David did. Nobody's done so much sin that God can't deal with it. Now, I want us to go back over. Now, we've been talking about this. One more time, go to Hebrews, the third chapter. I'm not going to read all of it, but I'm going to read a part of it here. In Hebrews, the third chapter, where the Scripture says, there in verse 8, harden not your hearts as in the provocation. The provocation is a reference. The word provocation comes from the word provoke. It means they provoked God to anger because when they got out here in the desert, in that tongue right there, they had to come down to Mount Sinai to get the law of God. That was just the beginning. They started complaining as soon as they got in the wilderness down here, and when they leave here and head up to what was right at the Gaza Strip, but it was called the land of Anak, and the Anakims were real big men, and that's where their trouble started, and they started really griping, complaining. They complained as soon as they got across the river. How are we going to eat? What's going to be our food? And God had just destroyed this most powerful army in the world. As far as power, for the day and time, they were as powerful an army as that's ever lived. Of course, they had bows and arrows and swords and so forth. But as far as what they had, no one could conquer them except God. Now, I want us to go back over here to Numbers. And we've been talking about, well, not Numbers, Hebrews. Hebrews 3, He's talking about they could not enter into his rest because of their own unbelief. And it was their wrath that caused God for 40 years to kill off all the unbelievers in Israel that came in. And God knew who they were. God didn't have to say, is anybody unbelieving here? He knew who the unbelievers were. He killed them. That's the picture and the shadow of God through all kinds of trials and tribulation and all the things that they went through. That is equivalent to our trials and tribulation over here to kill off this outer man. And as we read through this, you're going to see this. Then he says, but with whom was he grieved 40 years? Down in verse 17. Was it not with them that had sinned, whose carcasses fell in the wilderness? It was those who didn't believe that God could whip all their enemies out there in the wilderness and satisfy their hunger and their thirst. God took care of them. Their feet didn't swell up for 40 years. That's something, isn't it? And you're in a desert where it's 120 degrees. And he'd bring water out of a rock and a cloud by day and a fire by night to lead him. I would think. And besides, he already destroyed Pharaoh's armies after 10 plagues in Egypt. And they still didn't believe. The unbelievers didn't believe. That's a picture of this man right here that wants to fight God. And they think these people here that are giving him a hard time, they think it's the people, they don't know it's God up here manipulating their lives to give you a hard time until you quit. Boy, that's something. And to whom swear he that they should not enter into his rest, but to them that believe not. They didn't believe all of this that's coming in their life is of God. If we can learn to believe that our bad times were put there by God to get a hold of our brains over a certain period of time, so you can stop worrying and stressing and fighting and fussing with the world. That's all it's for. It's so he can get our attention. He says, and to whom swear he that they should not enter into his rest? Katapausis, that is what they did on the Sabbath. He goes on to compare that katapausis with the Sabbath. Kata meaning down, and pauses mean to pause or settle down. Now, if you have problems, start bowing to God. If you can't see how it's supposed to work out, read the Proverbs and Psalms and get your concordance and line up all the wisdom verses and all of the knowledge verses and all the instruction verses, and God will tell you what's going on in your life and what it's for. That's amazing. We have the very instruction book in front of us, and we won't read it enough to find out what's going on in our lives. It's not the person at work. You'll find the answer in here. He'll tell you why he's doing that. He won't name their name, but he say, the man that does so-and-so and despises reproof, he is brutish. Oh, that's that guy I work with. That's that woman over here. That's the lady next door. And you don't know where they are. You're not even supposed to try to figure out where they are or whether they're a believer or not. You're supposed to accept what they're doing. And I'm not saying you don't approach them, but approach them very gently, very kindly. You don't go, what do you think you're doing over here parking your car in my driveway? That's not, you could go over and say, sir, I have to go somewhere. Would you mind moving your car? I've got to go to the grocery store. Just whatever. And still, you don't get mad if they say, well, so what? There's always an answer to what they're doing, but it's going to have to be a Christ-like answer. We had been informed that the lady next door when we moved into the house was really hard to get along with, so Mary went over there one day and talked to her, and she was very congenial. Don't listen to everything. Don't act on what you heard somebody say. Now, look over here in Numbers. Look at Numbers. I don't know how far I've gone in this. Numbers 11. Numbers 11. I think I went to Numbers 14, I believe. Numbers, well, I'll read a couple of things in Numbers 11. Now you've got to remember, everything in when they were out here in the wilderness, this is actually the first part or the end of Exodus and Leviticus. And then when they get down to the mountain, they get to the mountain in Numbers 10, or excuse me, they get to the mountain in Exodus 18. He goes up in the mountain in Exodus 20 and gets the Ten Commandments. Comes back down, he keeps going back up and down until he gets all the Levitical law of the Levites. And then in Numbers 10, they leave the mountain of God and go up to Kadesh Barnea, and God commands them to go in here and conquer this land in southwestern Israel, which is today is the Gaza Strip, where the Palestinians' headquarters is, and they're the ones that's firing missiles over here into Israel and battling them over the land. And that was called the land of Anak back in that day and time. It was also the land of the Philistines during David's day. So they're going up here, and they say, we can't conquer those giants. They're too big. They're tall. They're strong. And they did not believe God. Those people that did not believe God, here's what you need to understand. That's the unbelief that's equated with this outer man over here. So God says, when all the soldiers went up there, 20 years old and upward, that was the age you had to be to serve in the military in Israel, 20. So everyone that was at least 20 that went up there to the land of Anak to spy it out, and they came back and said, we saw men carrying clusters of grape, took two of them on a pole to carry the clusters of grape. It was such a rich land. They said, it's truly a land flowing with milk and honey. But they said, we can't conquer those Anakims. They had forgotten that God destroyed Pharaoh's armies. Just opened up the sea, and they ran in there, and poof, it's over. Drowned them all. So everybody, every unbeliever that did not say, let's go into the land and conquer the land, the sentence was pronounced upon them that they had to die in the next 40 years in the wilderness. Every one of those soldiers that would not go in, and there's only two men that was a soldier that said, we'll go in and take the land. And who was that?
Joshua and Caleb.
Huh?
That was Caleb
and Joshua. All the rest of those were pictures, along with every other instance they come across and God has to kill men, including that man that gathered sticks in Numbers, the 15th chapter, God says, kill him. In Numbers, the 16th chapter, God says, Korah and his followers, kill them. That's all a picture of the unbelief of this man here in this fleshly body that we're in. If God can destroy our fleshly desires, and let me tell you what he can do. He can make you old and destroy them. Your fleshly desires are going to go away when you get old. You're going to quit defending yourself, fighting with somebody. I really believe that the biggest problem with us is fighting over our fleshly desires. I believe that. It's over our own orge, our own wrath. That's the feminine gender wrath. It's the wrath of Babylon, the mother of harlots, that's founded on self, or let us make us a name. Self, I want my way. And I don't care who it is. God says, you're not going to have your way. I'm going to have my way, and I'll kill your enemies when I want them dead. Nobody's going to kill them without my orders. Reminds me of Ahab, when Ahab was just misruling Israel and murdering Naboth and all this, and Ben-Hadad came down to Israel and said, I want your unconditional surrender. And God says, told a prophet, you go tell Ahab, now he's a wicked king, and he's my king of northern Israel, but you tell him to go out there and attack this Ben-Hadad and his forces. And they didn't have many fighters in Israel, but they went out there and just whipped them bad. And Ben-Hadad sent a message down there and said, well, your God's the God of the mountains. He can't whip us on the plain. Boy, it made Jehovah God angry. And they went out there, and then the Syrians covered the plain. And I've said it so many times, Israel had 7,000 fighting men, and they came up against about 120,000 Syrians. And Israel destroyed them, and they encamped against them like two little flocks of kids. God says, I will kill Ahab when I'm ready. Don't you tell me when my evil king's going to die. And God will get rid of this man here when he's ready, not when you're ready. It'll be a place you come to, you put your hands in the air and you say, I surrender, God. I'm not going to fight you anymore, Lord, and I'm going to start with these enemies of mine. I'm not going to fight them. I'm going to leave them alone. How much time do I have, Mike?
You've got about 15 minutes.
Oh, Mike, you're not Mike.
15 minutes.
15. Let's go over here to Numbers. Gosh, I don't know where to go to. Go to Numbers 11. Numbers 11. You can take everywhere you find the wilderness in the New Testament and the adventures of the children of Israel in the wilderness, you can compare that with us here in the world fighting our individual outer man who doesn't believe God. The way you prove you don't believe God is you fight all your enemies. We're never supposed to be fighting our enemies. David said, Lord, you plead my cause. Why do you think David said that? Rube is the word plead. It means fight for me. I can't fight for myself. I go out here and commit sin, and you end up having my eldest son, Amnon, rape my daughter, Tamar, and then Absalom, my fourth son, comes up, plans and plots to kill Amnon 2 years later, and he does. And then Absalom comes up, and all the people love Absalom, and Absalom says, I think it's time for me to take over my father's kingdom. David says, I can't fight nobody no more. You've raised up people in my own house to fight me. You can't fight God. People that try to argue with the fates are what God, there's nothing going on in the world that God hasn't ordained. He works all things after the counsel of his own will. He's declared the end from the beginning and from ancient times. Everything that's not yet done. Everything that's not yet done. Whatever is going to happen tomorrow, he's already declared it. Whoever robs a grocery store, shoots somebody, runs over them with a car, gets drunk, kills somebody in a drunken car wreck, ends up in prison. God's declared all that too. People don't like the idea when you say he's declared everything. It's going to happen the way he's said. And you're even going to be contrary in your sin, believers, until he gets you out of it by putting you in enough scourging. You say, Lord, I'm going to quit fighting everybody. I'm going to quit blaming the world. I know that you're the cause. You're not to blame. You are the cause. But people don't believe this. This is too much predestination. They don't believe it. And proof that we don't believe it is we want to still fight it at times. Don't we? I'll get those people. They ain't going to treat me like that at work. Yes, they are. They're in charge, aren't they? I've had people say, I keep telling off my boss. I say, why? Who's the boss there? Well, he is. And who writes the paychecks? Well, he does. And you're going to tell him off so he can fire you and lose your job? How crazy are you? Now, he says over here in Numbers, the people say in Numbers 11 chapter, verse 4, and the mixed multitude that was among them fell lusting, and the children of Israel wept again and said, who's going to give us some flesh to eat? All we've got is this manna bread. Gripe, gripe, gripe. And now our soul is dried away there in verse 6, and there's nothing at all beside this manna before our eyes. In verse 10, and Moses heard the people weep throughout their families, every man in the door of his tent And the anger of the Lord was kindled greatly, and Moses was displeased. He brings them out there, gives them water out of a rock, fights all their enemies. That's a picture of us, and we keep complaining. And God has delivered them. They may as well be sitting in an air-conditioned den somewhere over there in Israel. Because God says, I can make you cool. I can make you warm. I'm going to keep your feet from swelling up. If you could just walk outside, God says, I'm going to make you food. I'm going to pay a car payment. I'm going to do everything. You won't even need a car. I'll just slide you along across the top of the ground. And God says, I want to supply everything while your enemy is trying to destroy you. And this outer man, this fleshly man says, oh, they ain't going to do me that way. God says, look, what I have to do to get you to believe me? I guess kill that part of you that won't behave. And that's not you, that's the outer man. He's going to keep alive that inner man, Christ in you. That's all he kept alive to cross the river with. Moses said unto the Lord, wherefore hast thou afflicted thy servant? Wherefore have I not found favor in thy sight, that thou layest the burden of all this people upon me? There's Moses griping. Lord, forgive me for griping. Have I conceived all this people? Have I begotten them? That was you, that thou shouldest say unto me, carry them in thy bosom as a nursing father beareth the sucking child into a land which thou swearest unto their fathers. See, sometimes Moses didn't like his job too well. He's complaining too. When should I have flesh to give unto all this people? For they weep unto me, saying, give us flesh that we may eat. We want some. We're tired of nothing but vegetables. We're tired of nothing but this bread that you drop out of heaven. Give us flesh that we may eat, and I am not able to bear all this people alone because it is too heavy for me. And if you deal thus with me, kill me, God, I can't stand it. Well, I think that's what Elijah said. Lord, I've had all I can take. Kill me. God said, I'll tell you when it's time to die. They're completely comfortable out here. I believe they were completely comfortable in the heat. And they're saying, we want it to look like we're in comfort. We want a nice pool over here with some fish in it and a palm tree and laying in a hammock drinking our orange juice or pineapple juice or whatever.
You know what? They're probably bored and all they thought about was food.
That's all they're thinking about. And if thou deal thus with me, kill me, I pray thee, out of hand. And if I have found favor in thy sight, let me not see my wretchedness. The Lord said unto Moses, gather unto me 70 men of the elders of Israel, whom thou knowest to be the elders of the people and officers over them, and bring them into the tabernacle of the congregation, that they may stand there with thee. And I will come down and talk with thee there, and I will take the spirit of the Spirit which is upon thee. You think that's any different than the Holy Spirit that's the truth in the New Testament?
No.
Same thing. And will put it upon them, and they shall bear the burden of the people with thee. These elders will, 70 of them, it's amazing, 70, that thou bear it not thyself alone. There were 70 elders that was called the Sanhedrin during Jesus' day that judged in Israel. And say thou unto the people, sanctify yourselves against tomorrow, and ye shall eat flesh. For ye have wept in the ears of the Lord, saying, who will give us flesh to eat? We're unhappy with just this manna. For it was well with us in Egypt. Therefore the Lord give you flesh, and you shall eat. Ye shall not eat one day, nor 2 days, nor 5 days, neither 10 days, nor 20 days, but even a whole month until it comes out your nostrils. You want banana pudding? I'll give it to you for 10 years. You'll hate it by then. And if it be loathsome unto you, because you have despised the Lord, which is among you, and have wept before him, saying, why came we forth out of Egypt? Moses said, the people among whom I am are 600,000 footmen. Boy, they had a lot of people. That was just in Moses. Moses, Levitical. Do you realize how many people were out there in the wilderness? He said, I had 600,000 footmen. And thou hast said, I will give them flesh that they may eat a whole month? Shall the flocks and the herds be slain for them to suffice them, or shall all the fish of the sea be gathered together for them to suffice them? Am I going to have to take all the fish out of the sea to make you happy and to give you a fill? And the Lord said unto Moses, Is the Lord's hand waxed short? Thou shalt see now whether my word shall come to pass unto thee or not. You think my hand is so short I can't supply your needs? I killed everybody in Egypt, all the firstborn in Egypt. I conquered Pharaoh and his armies and killed him and all of his armies. You think God can't? Well, he just doesn't understand my situation. Well, you hadn't to walk around in the desert for 40 years yet, have you? Thou shalt see now whether my word shall come to pass unto thee or not. And Moses went out and told the people the words of the Lord, and gathered the 70 men of the elders of the people, and sat them round about the tabernacle. And the Lord came down in a cloud and spake unto him, and took of the Spirit, that's the Holy Spirit, the truth, that was upon him, and gave it unto the 70 elders. And it came to pass, when the Spirit rested upon them, they prophesied and did not cease. But there remained two of the men in the camp, the name of one Eldad, and the name of the other Medad. And the Spirit rested upon them, and they were of them that were written, but went not out into the tabernacle, and they prophesied in the camp. And there ran a young man and told Moses and said, Eldad and Medad do prophesy in the camp. And Joshua the son of Nun, the servant of Moses, one of the young men, answered and said, My Lord Moses forbid them. And Moses said unto him, Enviest thou for my sake? Would to God that all of the Lord's people would go out and prophesy. These men have the guts to get out there in the congregation, and you're wanting them to back off. And that the Lord would put his Spirit upon them. And Moses got him into the camp, and he and the elders of Israel. And there went forth a wind from the Lord, and brought quails from the sea, and let them fall by the camp as it were a day's journey on this side, and as it were a day's journey on the other side, round about the camp. Can you imagine that? God blows these quails in from the sea. They had to be flying out over the sea. They weren't swimming in the sea. And that's for several hundred thousand people. God is saying, you think I can't solve your situation? I've learned that my situation usually that I think needs solving because I need to tell somebody off. I used to think that. That'll solve it. I'll tell them off and we'll give them what for, and I'll have my vengeance. God says, you don't need vengeance. I can solve every situation. If I can blow enough quail from the sea to feed hundreds of thousands of people, isn't it amazing what God would do to prove himself? And he does that in our lives, and we act like we don't have good sense. I used to act like I didn't have good sense. I've got better sense now because I'm learning to trust the Lord and put everything in his hand. I don't get upset at anybody. I've had situations recently that at one time would have upset me, and sometimes I'll just sit back. I don't even tell Mary about it, and I'll grin thinking, boy, there's a time I would have just gone berserk over that. I just think it's funny how God can calm you down. People have left here that at one time I would have screamed and gotten mad and jumped up and down, and I just look at it and say, back to work. That's what we have to do. And brought quails from the sea and let them fall in the camp as it were a day's journey on his side, as it were a day's journey on the other side, round about the camp, as if it were 2 cubits high upon the face of the earth. 2 cubits high, all these quail. A cubit is 1.5 feet. That's 3 feet high. They're spread out everywhere. And the people stood up all that day and all that night and all the next day, and they gathered the quails. He that gathered least gathered 10 omers, and they spread them all abroad for themselves and round about the camp. And while the flesh was yet between their teeth, ere it was chewed, The wrath of the Lord was kindled against the people. He says, I'm going to have it coming out your nostrils. You know what he said? You think you have to command the Lord to fix your situation? That's called unbelief. And these unbelievers are going to be killed, and God's going to know who they are. And that's a picture of our outer man. Kindled against the people, and the Lord smote the people with a great plague. They were the unbelievers. And he called the name of that place Kibroth Hattaavah, because they buried the people that lusted. God killed them. He knows who's... He knows the unbelieving man and how he needs to die. Well, I want what I want. You know what God will do? He'll give you what you want till you hate it. I used to want to be a famous singer, and I'd get up and sing. When I first started singing professionally in about 1962, I thought I'd love that the rest of my life. I hate three-part harmony gospel music. I can't stand it. Not because I failed. It's because God has taught me through all of the scriptures. I want to ask some of these gospel singers, aren't you sick and tired after 50 years, nothing but high notes and low notes and three-part harmony in the middle? Gosh, like I said a while ago, give me banana pudding. I love it. But don't feed it to me every day for 10 years. I ain't going to like it after a week. Well, God says, you got it. You asked for it. Eat it. And that's what he's telling them. They're fighting him. Isn't that amazing? And the people journeyed. Kibroth Hattaavah unto Hazeroth and to Hazeroth. And they start fighting God again in the next chapter. They go from one chapter to the next, arguing with God. He says, you won't, okay, you won't quails here. Just like a little cartoon. I'll cram it down your throat and it'll come out your nostrils. Then I'm going to kill you for not believing me. And we've got an outer man that has to die. Some people don't believe in faith increasing. Well, if you don't, you don't believe that outer man has to die, and you don't believe the book of Numbers.
They don't believe the Bible,
period. It's all the unbelief. Anytime you get to Deuteronomy, that's right before they cross the river. And anytime God is talking to Israel right before they cross the river, he's killed off all the unbelief. In the book of Deuteronomy, when the Bible says choose life, he's not talking to unbelievers about accepting Christ. He's not saying choose to be saved. He's saying choose life when you get into this land. Don't go after unbelief. Same thing I'll say to people here. Start believing God about your life. You say, Jim, I can't get a hold of that. I know that, but it's going to take a little bit of step forward. You're going to have to change your whole ways. I am not the man that I was when I was 45 and 50. Ask my wife. I'm not the same person. I'm completely different than I was then. God will do that to you in time, but make some effort on your own part to try to, along the way, to make an effort to, when you're about to lose it, up here in your mind, and it'll come out of your mouth, wherever you are, say, I'm not going to react to this. And bite your tongue. Count to 10,000. They used to say years ago, count to 10. I say, count to 10,000. If you will wait, if somebody offends you today, and I'll tell you, and I'll say to you, you say they offended you, okay. What I want you to do is wait till Saturday to tell them off, okay? And here it is Wednesday. You know what will happen by Saturday? Your whole thought process will change, won't it? Everything that you were going to say, you lost a job because of something you said, didn't you? If you'd waited 3 or 4 days, I'll tell them off in 3 days. Then you won't. Because you think of the ramifications, you think of what you could do, a better way to approach it. We're not supposed to react like it's, you know what the problem comes in? Whenever you think somebody's doing you wrong, the problem is in your reaction as a believer. That's it. how you react. Somebody upsets me, I won't say something to them. If I know they're doing something completely wrong, I'll wait and wait and wait. And I may say something up here or just, but that happens with everybody. Don't we know that? Dennis, have you ever had something that you just did it wrong and answered it wrong? I know you have. I don't have to ask you that. Yeah. All right. Well, I'm out of time. I'm going to come back and try to get into Numbers quicker. And you're going to see Numbers 12, Numbers 14, the people get crazy. Have you ever gotten crazy because of the outer man? Let me assure you, it's not your enemies, it's God. What you've done is made an enemy of God when you try to fight against His sovereign will. Let's pray. Father, thank you for truth. Lord, help us to understand. I know why you've put me through all this, so I can help teach this to the people. Thank you for all the trials I've gone through that's gotten a hold of my patience and caused me to be more compassionate. I wish I could really fully understand it. I pray you'll cause me to understand it fully and completely, how to deal with people. Maybe when I'm 90, but Lord, I do desire that more than anything in my life. Help us to live by your word, mature the sheep, and we'll give you praise for everything in Christ's name. Amen. I'm sorry, but I'm not sorry. Life is tough, isn't it? Whew.
What was those three things that wisdom? You said growing it.
Wisdom and understanding and knowledge, mainly. Wisdom, understanding, and knowledge.
Okay, and you said, look in Proverbs, Psalms. And
just Proverbs and Psalms. You're going to have more than you read in there. And instruction. Instruction.
Exactly
wisdom,
what
knowledge.
It's what's been happening to me for the last couple of weeks.
Huh? Oh, okay. We've all been through it. Everybody's been through it. There's no exceptions. We let our mouth get us in trouble. That's everybody that lives, especially believers, especially preachers. They get themselves in trouble.
You'll know when you're acting. And if you really believe God.
Hey, John.
You ain't doing much.
Who's that guy right there? Guy in red.
Yeah, that's all you need to do. You won't answer. That's just the way life is.
Oh, is that the one that I said?
No, so I'm trying to break.
Well, if they had that, if the thing is good, customers, they couldn't get that money. You should understand that.
You know, but see, God doesn't understand my situation.
God has never had a situation like that. That is a lot worse than, that's a lot worse than being in the wilderness with 3 million people. You had a thing that God could not possibly understand.
How you go to school? You
know, actually, I'm here for the same thing, the crazy
You like
part.
It?
You know that.
Are you learning? Are you making eggs already?
How do you go anywhere when you're in two cubits of quail? How do you get anywhere?
Scott had him in a mess. He had him walking in.
Let me see your teeth.
Yes, but he's going to punish him because of their complaint. You can put everything on the sovereignty of God, and he ain't going to let you off because he caused it.
He only had George Foreman grow back then.
He's going to let you off when he kills off the dead man in you. The only person that's going to be let off is the one that's going to be delivered, which is the inner man.
I have learned that, though,
what
we said, I have
learned
to do that.
You mean everything I said?
Breaking the lid.
You had learned to do what?
When I get angry and want to actually say something right then and there.
And quit thinking that people saying and thinking stuff. Most of the world is out here trying to live.
Just what I'm saying is I give it to you the next day. I know, I'll pull the same way.
Well, you learn that if you did that, you won't get in trouble. Hey, guys, come over and see me. Can I dig what? Can I dig a grave? Huh? Can I dig what?
Did you get all that, John? Did you get all that down?
You know what?
The sermon?
Come on, step over.
Did I get all?
Yeah.
What? I know this is all for your and everybody, but if you can learn to get into this, it helps.
And I understand that. You need to. You make it sound easy.
It's not easy. Exhausting. You have to learn to give up. You can fight until you keep fighting when you say, what am I doing?
He said, that's just something that's
right. And I do.
But that's the whole world. You don't need to feel like they're out to get you. And I can say that to anybody here. That's the whole world thinks everybody's out to get them. And they are, in a sense, they're not out to get individuals. They're out to get ahead. If they have multiple people on the door, that's what they're doing. You can't
crab
people to be what they are. God caused them to be.
Is that the red crab as far as
your thing you have to do is react
right.
Well, not react at all, though, right? Isn't that what
I'm saying? Your reaction should be correct, and not reacting is correct.
You got a hearing aid.
In other words, my reactions have not been.
You're the only person here who hasn't had.
I am the only one. That's right. Yep.
Everybody else is at it right except you.
Y'all got together.
Right?
Sure. No. I'll tell you.
Yeah.
Just stop and think before you react to be like Jesus.
Nobody gets under your skin.
Smack your parents upside
the head. Lisa? I know, you're right, that's right, you are right, that's right, all right, you got it.
The world don't
revolve around it.
It
doesn't?
No. My mouth always gets me in
trouble. Well, if you could say sometimes, that's why you're more ahead of me.
I'm just kind of like, Jim's something funny, right back.
She's a nut.
She's so bad after that.
We watch her in grimace as much now. He catches the references.
I wrote a
happy nut.
And then it wasn't 15, 20 minutes to play her up right now. I'm very, very sorry. I want to go high
and you know what I noticed about that? What I noticed about that is to follow.